This is UN News, I'm Conor Lennon. Small island developing states all have their unique qualities, but they have some obvious similarities. Tourism is often an important part of their economies. Many of them are vulnerable to extreme weather and rising sea levels, and the vast majority are heavily dependent on fossil fuels. Tourism, it's an energy-hungry business, and importing fossil fuels is expensive. Some island countries spend around a quarter of their national budgets on imported fuel. At the same time, most of these states are potentially well placed to benefit from renewable sources such as solar, wind, tidal, geothermal energy. So the question is, what's holding them back and how can they get to net zero? Well, to find out, I've come to Port of Spain, the capital of Trinidad and Tobago, which lies in the Caribbean, to speak to some experts who can hopefully answer these questions and educate me a bit on the subject. I have Ms. Sheena Gosine, Sustainable Energy Analyst at the Ministry of Energy, Mr. Kishan Kumarsingh, Head of Multilateral Environmental Agreements at the Ministry of Planning and Development, and Dr. Curtis Boodoo, Lecturer and Assistant Professor at the University of Trinidad and Tobago and an expert on the energy transition. Thanks to all of you for being here on what is, I know, quite a hot day. I'm not used to it myself, but I think you were saying earlier, even for you, this is particularly hot and humid weather. Sheena, let me start with you. In terms of your position as a sustainable energy expert and analyst, I talked earlier about the cost of fuel for many small island developing states, very, very high. You don't have that problem. I mean, you have a lot of oil and gas in this country. You're the largest producer in the Caribbean. I think fifth largest exporter of liquefied natural gas in the world. And the sector is of huge importance to your economy. It's really helped a lot for the development of Trinidad and Tobago, contributes so much to your GDP. So the question for you is, someone who's interested in sustainability, sustainable energy, does that mean that oil and gas is inevitably going to be around for the foreseeable future?
I think the government of Trinidad and Tobago is very cognizant of climate change and its impacts as a SID state, right? However, they have adopted an approach where we will utilize our resources, our hydrocarbon resources, towards binary benefits, where we continue get economic returns and we utilize that towards our journey, but towards decarbonization of our industries and our power generations and so forth. But it will definitely be a part of our future as we move forward. We are number 7 in the world in energy equity. We rank in 2023. So I think we've been successfully been able to provide affordable energy in an equitable way for our citizens, no matter their socioeconomic standing. And currently under construction, we have our first utility scale solar project, which should help meet the approximate 10% of that demand.
Okay, well, I'll just turn to you, Kishan. You've been intimately involved in these international climate discussions, COPs, the big UN climate conferences that take place every year. I feel like countries like Trinidad, small island developing states, have really managed to get their message across for countries which, you know, in the wider scheme of things, have quite small populations. Is that translating, though, into the finance you need? Because you need a lot of upfront finance to make this transition to clean energy.
For us here, we only have two renewable sources, sun and wind. And for solar energy plants to satisfy the industrial scale of production that we have, they would have to be vast. And that has its own inherent limitation because we're a small island, and therefore geographical space becomes an issue. So we are now looking to wind resource assessment to see the potential of wind energy. But all of that, as coming back to the point, takes money. The international negotiations invariably is underlined by financing. The Climate Change Convention itself, the Paris Agreement itself, speaks to the need for financing the achievements and the aspirations of developing countries and vulnerable countries, particularly those that are located in remote areas, the small islands especially. So the finance discussions is usually the trust maker or the trust breaker of the negotiations. We are at present negotiating a new global climate finance goal that is supposed to be concluded at COP29 in Baku in November. building on the promise of the $100 billion per year by 2020 that was made way back in 2009 prior to the Copenhagen conference, which I should add has not yet been met. So you understand the kind of trepidation and the mistrust, quite frankly, that underlines these negotiations of finance, because it's just not forthcoming. And it's critically important. If the globe has to collectively work towards a common goal of constraining temperatures to 1.5 degrees according to the Paris ultimate objective, then that requires cooperative action. And that cooperative action invariably involves finance to help those countries that are struggling to in the energy transition.
Well, let's look at some of these green shoots of progress towards a low carbon economy. And Curtis Boodoo, you've been involved in some of these, in particular a UN solar powered project which was funded by the EU. Tell us a bit more about that project and its potential.
So the project I was involved in focused on community solar. So we installed, or we had solar systems installed in 10 communities in Trinidad and 2 in Tobago. It was a very holistic project because not only did it involve contributing to the development of these communities, because these communities were diverse. We had communities that focused on tourism. We also installed solar for the educational sector. We looked at schools, the Red Cross, you know, so it was a diverse collection of communities and NGOs that would have benefited. We also would have provided training for them directly. So we got to interface with them, hear their views on solar, hear their views on the energy transition.
So tell me a bit more about what it meant. Like, when you say community, what size of community were we talking about, and what effect was this solar power project having on their lives?
Another example I would like to share is one where we provided solar for a NGO that deals with the leatherback turtles in Trinidad. So they have a facility that's very close to the beach, very remote. They don't have electricity. Again, they burn diesel using generators at night at that facility. And we would have provided them with solar and batteries. Again, we would have seen somewhat of a transformation in terms of persons coming to see the leatherback turtles, because they have a lot of tours that they do. The facility is now powered by electricity. They could do PowerPoint presentations. They could sell chilled beverages. These were things that was impossible before. So we have a lot of excellent case studies where we were able to transform good work done relating to biodiversity and the environment using solar in particular.
Working at a very local community level. Yes. The aim of these projects is to help put the country on a low carbon path, and it's not the only initiative of its kind, of course. The UN's also backing an initiative to develop low carbon alternatives to oil and gas whilst dealing with a particularly stinky and unsightly problem washing up on the country's beaches.
This brown grass looking thing that is covered on the beach, it's a seaweed or a macroalgae, and it is sargassum. My name is Adrian Wilson. I am the research officer here at Nature Seekers. Today we are in the village of Matura. We are actually on Matura Beach. It's on the east coast of Trinidad and Tobago. So sargassum, it's a seaweed, it's a macroalgae, and it's been around, it's been in our environment as long as we've known it. However, most recently, the abundance of it, the volume of it has become so vast that it kind of covers the shores at times. And it becomes problematic in that sense, just from the aesthetics to the smell, to the tourism industry that proliferates here as well. So it's a difficult situation that we deal with at times. Sometimes this entire beach is covered in sargassum. This beach is particularly important because it is a sea turtle nesting site. Most abundantly, we have leatherbacks nesting on this beach, and the sargassum becomes problematic for the nesting sea turtles. It also has been observed to be problematic for the hatchlings of the sea turtles in getting out of the nest and making it back to sea. The decay in sargassum isn't one that we really too like, and it isn't one that much persons enjoy. So it kind of pushes the tourism away from the beach in general. So basically we're removing as much seaweed as we can from this beach. We're going to be making gas out of the seaweed. And once we do that, we're going to utilize this gas as opposed to regularly used gases like liquid petroleum that have a much higher carbon footprint and contribute way more to climate change. This is something that once we are able to really show the value of it, it can be replicated everywhere that seaweed, the sargassum, is available. And it can be used, there definitely will be other uses of the fuel itself, because at the end of the day, that's what it is. It's a fuel and it can be used in additional industries. Maybe governments might look at it to fuel cars or transportation. We don't know where it can go, and there's a lot of potential around it.
There you go, some reasons to love sargassum. I'm sure you all are very fond of sargassum in this country. Curtis, first of all, looking at that and looking at the solar project you're talking about, as we say, you know, these are quite small scale. Can they be scaled up? Is that feasible in a country like Trinidad?
Yeah, sure. I think both Sheena and Kishan mentioned our first utility scale solar project that should come online later this year. So most definitely utility scale solar has a lot of opportunity in Trinidad. Kishan alluded to the fact that we are a small island developing state and space is small. So the use of solar for rooftop solar is perhaps the solution. The next step for solar after our utility scale solar would be to really encourage rooftop solar and decarbonize our electricity generation like that.
And Sheena, I'll ask you this. I think my understanding is that would need a lot of changes in legislation. How long would it take to really change the energy system so that people could put solar, they could be producing their own energy? It seems like it's going to be quite a lot of work.
We are actively on our way to do this. It all starts with overarching policy. We are actively reviewing our renewable energy policy, our feed-in tariff policy. Another worthy project hinging off of the GCC is also a macro installation done at our airport that is actually going to be commissioned soon. So what's the size, Curtis?
0.5 megawatts.
So it's larger than the systems that Curtis has installed at the communities. But you know, we'll have these three different, by the end of 2024, we'll have these different examples of systems that are on the grid, the smaller systems, the rooftop systems, the community systems.
I'll come to you in a moment, Kishan, but I just want to come back to you, Curtis. It's unfair to us, you both work for the government, so I'll ask Curtis this question, because you can speak freely, I'm sure. In your opinion, how long is it going to take for Trinidad, for this country, to transition to a low or no carbon economy?
Yeah. We are a unique SID in the sense that...
Small island developing state.
Yeah, small island developing state. We are unique because we are actually a net energy exporter. We are perhaps the only SID or categorized SID that is a net energy exporter. You mentioned about the vast volumes of natural gas that we would have exported or produced fifth in the world. Because of the war in Ukraine, we are actually the largest exporter of ammonia in 2022. So our petrochemical industry is vast as well. So in that sense, it will take us some time, and you use the word net zero, to be net zero. Because we can't only focus on power generation. I mean, our commitments for power generation are healthy, 30% by 2030. We already discussed projects that are helping towards power generation. I think the harder issues would be heavy industry, our petrochemical industries, LNG, which we have as well, manufacturing that we have in Trinidad. We do have the land issue. We have a healthy exclusive economic zone offshore. And guess what? We have experience dealing with, from the oil and gas sector, dealing with offshore. Offshore platforms, servicing and fabrication. We do that locally. So we actually start off with some expertise in this area. So to answer your question, whereas it will take some time for us to reach net zero, I feel that we actually have some expertise already. And I think we should look at net zero for us and our oil and gas sector as not being competing, but you could actually benefit from each. As I mentioned with offshore wind, you could benefit from the expertise in oil and gas. But if we have a significant amount of renewable energy from offshore wind, guess what? We could produce green ammonia. and we could attract a higher value for our ammonia. And we would be able to be resilient against any future carbon market or carbon tax for our petrochemical industries. So there is a harmony that you could find between our oil and gas sector and the energy transition.
Well, I've seen some nodding from our civil servants, so I don't think you upset anyone there, Curtis. And I'll end with you, Kishan. A few months' time, your team will be off to Baku, to Azerbaijan, for the next UN climate conference. What are you hoping for? What will you be pushing for at that conference?
We'll be pushing for the adoption of an ambitious climate goal, climate finance goal. But more than that, the mechanisms of access, affordability for finance, climate finance, to do what we need to do collectively is something that we would always want to see manifested pursuant to the decisions that are taken. So that's the headline issue for this year. Most of the other issues in the implementation of Paris Agreement has already been settled. We'll be looking forward to receiving more ambitious NDCs, nationally determined contributions, or commitments to reduce emissions from countries. The thing is, the dilemma here is this, and it's a reality that we can't escape. And the reality is that the world is warming faster than we could cope with it. In fact, every scientific report that comes out says that the rate of warming has previously been underestimated. The ultimate objective of the Paris Agreement is a 1.5 degree. No one talks about 2 degrees anymore, they talk about 1.5. At this moment, we are already at 1.15 degree warming.
And that has been catastrophic to many people around the world already.
But let me give you an idea of how catastrophic it can be. The 1.5 degree goal is likely to be met, if you can call it a goal, but that threshold is likely to be met in another 15 years at the current rate of warming, or so the science tells us. We live on an island, and many small islands are surrounded by coral reefs, which provide ecosystem services, fish, food security, pharmaceuticals, coastal protection, the list goes on. At 1.5 degrees warming, about between 70 and 90% of corals will be decimated. At 2 degrees warming, virtually all corals will be gone. We are on track for about 3 degrees warming in the next 75 years. That's three generations from now. My grandkids, my great grandkids. And that's the reality that we have to face. And we have to be politically sober about it. So as we negotiate within the Alliance of Small Island States as one voice, we have always been consistent in the call that more has to be done to reduce emissions. It has to be a collective action. Everyone has to be as ambitious as they can be, given their own national realities and circumstances. And so move towards, with earnest, reducing emissions towards that trajectory and that path. Otherwise, we stand to lose much more than we stand to gain from pursuing other interests for economic prosperity. So that will be our message that has been consistent over the years. But for this year, more access to more ambitious finance would be the main call.
Well, we really hope for more progress at the climate conference. Thank you all for explaining what the government's doing, and Dr. Boodoo for your involvement in the community projects. We wish you all the best, and please, we hope we'll be able to stay in touch to find out more about your progress to a lower carbon society.